No more netter baya. We seek refuge and pay homage to the Supreme Most High Creator, whom ordains and conducts all that exists and non-exists. Libation.
I say.
No more pert netteru baya. We seek refuge and pay homage to the company of our ancestors, who manifest as divine principles, laws, and attributes of love, light, nature, and virtues of the Most High Creator. Libation.
I say.
No more Guru-Baya. We seek refuge and pay homage to all the gurus, saints, and Sufis, and spiritual masters from time immemorial, from the known to unknown, and from our present cycle, for their immense love of the Dharma, the teachings, and humanity, who makes tremendous sacrifices on our behalf for the sake of self and God realization. Libation.
I say.
No more Dharma Baya. We seek refuge in the teachings of the great realizers, Buddhas, mystics, sages, and spiritual teachers and masters from time immemorial, from the known to unknown, and from our present time cycle. For we shall be as retainers of the gift of grace. Libation.
I see.
No more Sangat Baya. We seek refuge and pay homage to all of our spiritual communities across all time and space, which give us the impetus, strength, courage, and the help needed for the sake of self and God realization. Not just for our sake, but for the sake of all sentient beings. Libation.
Okay.
Nefer Mar Hotep, Ma'at Nefer Seba, Bhagwan Ra Afrika, Guru Mojibai, Ibae, Ashe. Aspiration plus courage plus patience equals spiritual attainment. Bhagwan Ra Afrika, Hotep forevermore. Peace, peace, peace.
Asato ma satam maya Toma amartam dhammaya tamasoma juktir gammaya shanti 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 amen. Lead us from the unreal unto the real, and lead us from darkness unto the light. And Lord, may thou lead us from death unto immortality. Peace, peace, peace.
I've been praying if I have. Thank you.
So if you will bear with me, I know some of you all were not able to get to the services for Guru-Dsiciple and the loss of her beloved sister, Betty Jean. Most of you probably in the sun got to know Betty Jean. Mm-hmm. And so we want to take a minute or two, if that's all right with you, to give Guru-Dsiciple back some of the love she lost in the loss of her sister. But that love that was in her sister is in her sister's mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so if you can tolerate us for a little bit, then let us take care of business. Mm-hmm. So Guru-Dsiciple, please. Where is Betty Jean's sons? Are any of us friends? Acha, come beloved.
Love, easy to love, hard to forget. just like him.
That's with everybody.
You brought to me tomorrow.
I would like to thank everybody who was supportive of my mom and helped Alina out. And I just wanted to say thank you to this crew. Thank y'all so much.
I would like to say the same as well. I wasn't here for the endurance of her ongoing, but I know she's in a better place than here now.
Yes,
no more pain and suffering.
Yes,
and I'd like to thank everybody for helping and supporting my auntie and my brother and my cousin during the struggle time that we're having.
Yes, sir.
Oh, yeah. Now she's moved on to a better place. Thank you all so much.
Most welcome.
I don't have words. I know you. And you've been there for me. And you're still here for me. And you'll always be here for me.
Yes, ma'am.
And I'll be here for you. So thank you, thank you, thank you from the bottom of my heart.
Rascals like to discuss.
So moving forward into this new year, what are some things that we should be mindful of in terms of cultivating the right view and pushing that forward throughout this year?
Well, certainly one of the things that one definitely should notice that this may be your last year.
Mm-hmm.
See? That must be factored into what you do the rest of this year, you see. In terms of the attitude we have to have on any legitimate spiritual path or engagement with any authentic spiritual process is the recognition of the your mortality and the inevitability of your death, you see. If you're fortunate, it'll be preceded by old age, sickness, some bad news from the doctor, and then that's all over with, you see. The new year should remind you how precious life is, particularly a human lifetime, you see, when you have this precious human body and all of the other equipment connected to it. For those who have heard teachings and have heard Dharma and so forth and so on, that makes this human lifetime even more precious, you see. And one must be resolved not to waste life, you see, to procrastinate, you see, to getting around to handling the business for which you have been given a human lifetime in the first place. To become capable of being the agency of love. Anything else you get done without getting that done is if you have done nothing. You have simply pissed away your human lifetime. So the new year then should sober you up, you see, somehow rescue you from the illusion that you're going to be here forever, you see, And this is help when there's a loss of a loved one, as you have just noticed. It reminds you, you too are going to die. You see, you don't know when, you don't know where, you don't know under what circumstances. You see, and your youth is not a sign that you got a lot of time, you see. Death occurs, either somebody murders you, or you die in an accident, or you live such a wayward life, such a loveless life, you fall into states of profound depression and you blow your brains out, suicide. You're going to go one of those four ways. And you don't know me. See? So, that's the gestaltship that the new year should bring. And of course you should be grateful that you have been given another year, another minute, another second, another week, another month. It should humble you and fill you with gratitude, you see. Today alone, probably 2 million people in the world died. They didn't wake up this morning. You did. So what are you going to do, boo? So it is this understanding about the tentative nature of human existence. A human lifetime is a terribly brief affair. You see? And you must live on the basis of such recognition. So there's more, of course. You know, lose some weight if that helps. All kinds of things, but the most important thing is to enter it wiser this year than you were the year before. Something else about it? That's enough. More than enough. Something else you rascals would like to consider? Most welcome. Yes, beloved.
Rashe,
take a look at the hotel.
Speaking of the new year, prayerfully, I'll be 68 on Wednesday. If I can make it.
Congratulations. Thank you. Yes, sir.
I had a question. As I reflect on when I smoke a little medical marijuana for my cataracts, does the mind, body and spirit get high, or is just the mind and the body? I'm trying to understand. Real talk.
Well, fundamentally, the biology and the physiology and the neurology of what you call high, it's just a change in the oxygen going to the brain. Are you with me? It has some impact on the nervous system and so forth and so on, you see. But that's all that amounts, you see. It is, of course, in medical cases, you have to consult with your doctor if they're going to keep you alive a little longer. But the fundamental consideration is, what good is health if you ain't doing nothing with it? What's the point? See, health in and of itself is not the ultimate goal. It's to be healthy for what purpose? To seek health, to go to the mall? a little dancing every Friday night, so forth and so on. That's not the goal, you see. You want to have a healthy body and mind so that you can have an advantage in attaining your purpose in life, which is love. Self-realization, God-realization, you see. That's what you're here to do, you see. If you're using your health for any other purpose, it's just a waste, you see. So doctors and medicine and all those, yes, that's important, you see. Naturally, your mind has to be in good shape, you see, along with the body. Many of the facet of spiritual practice, real spiritual practice, involve the disciplining of the body, especially in the form of meditation, you know. Your body has to be very strong to be able to sit for 2 or 3 hours. You can't do that with a weak body. Are you with me? So you need health, because you need the body to travel a spiritual path. You can't do any kind of sadhana without the body. It just cannot happen. It starts with a healthy body. Are you with me? That's why diets are changed, so forth and so on. You see? But it doesn't end with just a healthy body. But a healthy body is very important. Even equally important, perhaps even more important, is a healthy mind. You see? A mind that is clear, you see, free from all of this tendency to be distracted. You see, you can't be stayed on the Lord because your mind is not healthy. It's full of ill will, anger, lust, greed, vanity, you see. So many other negative thoughts. It can't meditate. Yes, you can train the body if you help it. Okay, good, but the mind still. The body doesn't meditate, the mind meditates. But the two are connected. Are you following me? Yes.
Okay. I was trying to use that as an analogy in terms of understanding the difference between mind, body, and spirit. In other words, when the marijuana smoker gets high, we know the body and the mind is kind of
affected. You know, yes.
But is the spirit somewhere saying, no, don't do that?
No. The spirit is just that which is aware of the body, mind, and the changes that go on in it when you smoke weed, drink alcohol, or when you have any experience for that matter, with the speaker test, these kind of things. You see, any experience that you have it, at the level of body and mind, emotions, etc., etc., it's simply being witnessed, you see. When we talk about spirit, or in some tradition, like in Hindu tradition, it's called sakshi, the witnessing consciousness. Are you with me? It is simply aware. It's not even affected by it. Are you with me? But the criteria is that you must actually be having the experience of being a spirit. Most people, while they talk about I'm body, mind, and soul, they're not having any conscious experience of being spirit. Are you with me? They are more identified with body, mind, and its history, its biography, its likes, its dislikes, the persona, the personality, the individual, etc., etc. Almost no conscious awareness of being just spirit, just consciousness, just this pure awareness. It's like the sky, rain, fall, lightning flash, thunder, rumble. The sky is not touched. And when one is able to shift their sense of self and identification from the body mind, then there is shanti. There's peace that surpasses all understanding. And to achieve that is the golden purpose of authentic religion or authentic spiritual practice, you see. Is to become self-realized. As the ancient African sages and mystics, even down to these most modern times, puts it, know thyself. For real. You see. And even if you only have an intellectual understanding of that, that's a beginning. If you believe you are a spirit, act like it. And stop acting like your mind and body and your emotions. You see. These are instruments, beautiful instruments. Don't misunderstand me. You see. Angels wants to have this, what we have now, this human body and all of its faculties. Beings and other levels, they want this. Hmm? They want this thing. Hmm? That you have now. Hmm? Spirit having a human experience. Much more can be said. Something else you ask would like to discuss? You see. See this thing, beloved, the sakshi, the spirit, the soul, this don't die, body dies. Not spirit.
Where does the spirit go?
It don't go anywhere. It's not in time and space. Gold pertains to time and space. Right? It is that which is prior to time and space. Time and space exists within it, not the other way around. It was never born. It will never die. It is outside of time. Only things that appear in time and space ends in time and space. Consciousness doesn't. It transcends. It is prior to. It's a very profound matter. You see? That becomes the purpose of satsang, spiritual conversations that we engage in with these great seers, is to help recognize who you are fundamentally. You see? All of our suffering and our sorrow is the result of misidentification with that which is not itself. This sense of self that you're having right now, it disappears around about midnight in deep dreamless sleep. You see, you are not who you feel you are at this moment. But that which you are does not cease to exist. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Nor are you your mind. You are that which is aware of what's going on in your mind. Are you with me? This is the goal. This is the opportunity that you can only have in this precious human body. It is something. It is something. Mm-hmm. And much, much more can be said about it. We've been talking about this great mystery, you see. For almost 30 years, and yet we're just scratching the surface. Because it's profound, it is beyond ordinary intellectual comprehension. You see, there's things that you can't know intellectually. You see, you have to have the experience. Are you with me? You have to experience truth of your real nature. And for that, you have to engage in a spiritual process. There is no other way. You can't resort to just eating certain kinds of food and doing these kind of rituals and ceremonies. None of that results in self-realization at all. And this is what is pointed out, you see. So, beloved, all these spiritual teachings is just pointing out the truth within your own experience. You don't have to read 10,000 books. Mm-hmm. Just pay attention to your actual experience. You see? The sense of self you operate in, that doesn't persist over into dream and deep sleep without dream. And that which is come and goes can't be real by definition. True?
Yes, sir.
Awareness does not come and go. It's aware of this waking state experience, it's aware of whatever goes on in the dream, and it's aware of the disappearance of every phenomenon. It threads through all of your experiences. You just don't notice it because you're distracted, you see, via your attention. You are caught up in the world. I don't want to put y'all to sleep. Just wait till midnight, then, you know, you'll understand this. Something else you rascals would like to consider. Yes, beloved.
Bhagwan, excuse me. Again, however, they're interesting. The spirit, and some people call it the soul, is inexplicable. So, would that be the creator?
Yes, it is incomprehensible. It is. As our African ancestors call it, it is amenera, unknowable. Mm-hmm. You cannot know it via the process by which you make your ordinary knowledge, you see? Almost everything you know due to the operation of your five senses of perception, seeing, touching, tasting, feeling, smelling, etc. This can't be seen. With the eyes, it can't be heard with the ears. So it transcends the very way that you go about creating knowledge. In philosophy, what we call epistemology, your style of creating knowledge. You see, in fact, the simple system of creating knowledge via the data that comes in through your five senses of perception, that ain't even reality, let alone knowledge. You can't see things the way things really are, you see.
Yes, sir.
That's why it remains incomprehensible to you, you see. You simply take in data from your five senses into your mind and you perform some kind of logical or most often illogical performance upon that data. You see, it's not here, you see. Even in quantum mechanics and deep science, you see, everything you see, you're seeing form, color, so forth and so on. This is just whirling streams of light here. You see, atoms swirling. It feels solid because you don't have the sensitivity necessary to feel the emptiness of things. The mic you hold in is mostly empty. The body you're standing in. Things are not the way they appear to your five sensory systems of perception. Are you following me? Now, I'm glossing it, beloved, you see. We will have to have a much longer conversation about it. You know, we have to really go into it very deeply, you see, to really appreciate this argument. I'm scratching this.
Yes, I understand.
But this becomes the problem, you see.
Yes, sir.
Right. Yes. And so you can be, you are that already. It's not that you got to see it. You see? you are already that. It's about recognition. You see? It's about that.
It's a very profound
thing. It's a very profound thing.
Bring to one other thing.
Yes, brother. Just one? We're going to back up on brother, all right.
Yeah. The ancient Hindu, amongst others, made a statement, according to studies, that about God creation. Did man create God? Our God created man. You remember, and I asked you that before. And it's very enlightening, the response that you gave.
Now, to give you a little closer response to that, you know, it's a little dangerous, but the reality is that there is no distinction between the two. Man is God. Everything is God. Nasaram Vidyate Kavasi, as the Hindus say. Everything that exists is simply a manifestation of God. To take the argument and make it a little bit more simple. If in the beginning there was only God and nothing else, then everything else that comes into existence by definition has to be a manifestation of God. You see? There is no distinction. You see? Self and God realization occur simultaneously. So the Hindus have a saying in their, what they call their Mahavakyas, their great statements, one of which is Aham Brahmasmi. You see, when one realizes oneself, one realizes I am Brahman. You see, and mystical Islam, you see, when one really attains self-realization, they simultaneously exclaim, you see, Allah, I am God, you see, which is blasphemy in Islam, and like Mansur, they'll kill you. In Christianity, if you're seeing God, if, you know, if you're seeing me, you're seeing the Father, etc., etc. You see, Anukasa, ancient Africans, when they realized that, you see, self-realization is the realization you are already that which you are calling God. This gets very profound, but now you just can't repeat it. Aham Brahmasmi, Aham Brahmasmi, Aham Brahmasmi. You will never realize that you are God simply by repeating that like a mantra. It doesn't work like that. In fact, you will get deluded. One has to really engage in the purification process. That is spiritual practice. No fooling. Okay. You know, you'll say Aham Brahmasmi, but you will never act like that. It'll just be philosophy. Just information. Information doesn't transform you. Cannot transform you, by definition. Can motivate you, it's good. So that's the direct response and answer to your question. You see?
Yes, sir. Appreciate it.
There's much more we can say if we went into the Chetu and the Third and all of that, you know, because the ancient African sages went deep into that. But that would take many, many, many more conversations than what we have today to get into. And if you ever go to Egypt and walk the grounds of Karnak, you see, or some of the other temples, you'll see that being screened loud and clear. Loud and clear. You see? Yes, ma'am.
In your maturation as a seeker, what kept you very steady on the path? What kept you very steady? And how was it that you maturated through this Or am I not using the right word for your total experience?
That's a on-the-spot question because it's loaded with the assumption that I am mature. I don't want to make any claims one way or the other. I'll leave that to you. But the real answer to that, Grace, you see, is not something that I did. You see, it's grace. It's grace. And Shavaism, for instance, the whole system of spiritual development in Shavaism is based on the recognition that grace is the thing, you see? You were talking about the creator, you see? And in Shavaism, they talk about the creator in terms of some fundamental activities that the creator is engaged in. The first one is what they call creation, sriti. It creates. Then it sustains somehow. It sustains that which it has created, right? And it destroys that which it has created, you see. This is the unfolding and collapsing of the universe, you know, so forth and so on. Even in quantum mechanics, they say that the universe will only expand to a certain point and then it will collapse and reverse this direction. This is the spanda. But there were two other important activities, you see. The other fourth one is called nagraha. It hides itself. You see my point? It creates a kind of amnesia. It gets very deep. And then the fifth activity is what it called anugraha. Then it reveals himself to himself. He wakes himself up back into who he is, what he really is. So it gets very, very metaphysical, you see. But it's grace, basically. Now, the only thing that we can ever take credit for is becoming receptive to the grace. You see, that's your choice. You see, everybody has heard or will hear truth. You see, and whether you will accept that or not. Some people are receptive. Some people are not. Many people are called, few choose to accept the truth. So Jesus in his lifetime, you see, ruined that truth. 12 people. 12 people. You see. The Buddha, 43 years, 80 of them became enlightened. 80. And he traveled all over India and such. Only a few. Even in ancient times, there was only a few people. It wasn't like the whole African culture that came in with the mind. That wasn't what was happening. Just a few. Just a handful. So the answer to that is, as best I can give it, and the most honest response I can give, grace. I mean, you're my sister, you grew up with me. I mean, you know only grace could have changed. Anybody that grew up with me know that. Most definitely family, you know what I mean?
West Side.
West Side, London, the holy city, I'm at home. Yes, beloved.
You mentioned that the spiritual process is not about repeating the Hambramatsya meditation. Then what is the spiritual process besides the fact that you suggested it has to do with experience?
Well, I think you've been coming here a long time. You probably know that answer. You probably just have to kind of reflect a little bit.
Okay.
And it comes to you.
Guru Bhagwan.
Yes, beloved.
Have you and all of us at this service been here before?
That's your favorite question. That's always a good question. It's a relevant question. And it goes back to what we were saying earlier. You see, when you say you, you're referring to something. What is the reference of your use of that word, you or me, right? Those two words, you and me, are reference to this, the body, right? The ego, I, the sense of self that you have right now. You see? This particular configuration and form, what we call nama-rupa, name and form and so forth. That me and that you, that's a one-shot phenomenon. It doesn't come back. At the end of this life, that's the end of that. Are you with me? What does come back, though, is the mind and its nature. You see, its tendencies, what we call samskaras, its desire, vasana. That takes another body. Are you with me?
Yes.
And forms another sense of who and what they are. Are you with me?
Okay, you're saying the spirit takes another body.
No, the mind. The spirit takes nothing. You see? It's the mind, your tendencies, your habits. Bad example, it's like a fan, right? It's plugged in and the blades are rotating, right? And when you unplug it, the blades keep rolling for a minute, right? Something like that happens, you see? Your desires, your likes, your dislikes, your tendencies, you see? The pattern of your mind, that is what comes back and takes another form, you see? Like, another way of looking at it, this body wears out, it runs down, it has a shelf life, it doesn't last forever. You see, it's an instrument by which the mind that is sitting inside this body fulfills its desires, ambitions, etc., right? This thing runs out, those tendencies remain, and then another body forms around it, and it goes on. But it'll have a different name, a different gender, different race, everything. You see, this is a temporary configuration and equipment to fulfill desires that quote unquote been in your mind from the creation of it.
Yes, sir. So we don't come back as insects.
You don't come back as the same person you are this time. You know.
Right. We don't come back as insects and animals.
Oh yes, because the form that you will get and the recycling depends on the desires. Let's say that if you like violence, you like killing, you like hurting people, you like destroying things. Well, you don't need a human body for that to put you in an animal body. You see, the purpose of the universe is to fulfill your desires. That's what this place is purposed to do. All right? Now, if those desires that you operate out of in this human body is more appropriate for an animal body, well, the universe gives you an animal body. If all you're interested in is money, food, sex, and bodily comfort, you don't need a human body for that. You follow what I'm saying? A squirrel body would be sufficient. Because the universe is not going to have energy. Are you with me? It's going to create a context where you will have the best opportunity to exhaust and fulfill those kind of desires. You're hypersexual, you know what I mean? You like having sex? Okay, we have a rabbit body. It's all about your desires. So that's why they talk about cultivating these different kind of desires, you know, desire for God realization, self-realization, you see? Make those your primary ones, are you with me? And then the universe would just accommodate you. So it has a lot to do with what you're doing now. If you want to know what your previous life was like, look at this one. It tells you. If you want to know what your next vehicle will be, look at this one. Let's say if you are lazy and you don't want to do anything, you don't want to do no work, you want maximum return for minimum effort, okay, you'll be a tree in the forest somewhere. And that desire will get fulfilled. Are you following me? Now I'm being humorous about it, but that is fundamentally the physics of reincarnation. See, there's a science to it. It's not arbitrary. You see?
That's scientific.
Very good question. I hope we got a little bit more depth this time, but of course if not, when you come again, we'll be good. As a man thinking, so does a man become. It's like that. Yes, beloved.
Master, I'd like to piggyback off of what my brother just
said.
Very
good.
And it's interesting. Because you touched on so much in a second, your karma. My question is about detachment.
Mm.
I just heard you mention, I can't use your exact words, but to paraphrase, you just mentioned that it's part of this process is transforming the desire for the worldly to the desire for that which is godly. Mm-hmm. Not your exact words, but
yes.
I'm trying to relate that to detachment.
Yeah.
And as a layman, who's trying to understand how to best mature.
Yes.
My question is, what does detachment look like in this day-to-day world?
Mm-hmm.
It seems like you may have just given the answer,
mm-hmm.
But I'm wondering if you can just speak to that a bit more.
Mm-hmm. It is an excellent inquiry that you opened up here. You see, another way to look at who you are is to simply see yourself as nothing but a accumulation of likes and dislikes, basically. You see? You define your own so-called uniqueness on the basis of, well, I like this and I don't like that, that's the way I am, et cetera, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
So you identify psychologically with likes and dislikes, you see? Even more than with this body. Are you with me?
Yes.
Now, these likes and dislikes take you into the realm of attachment. You see, attachment is one of the negative qualities of the mind that has to be overcome. You see? So obviously you're attached to your likes and so forth and so on. That is what has to be transcended. This mudra, this infatuation with what you like. You see, because your life basically consists of pursuing that which you like and trying to avoid that which you dislike. That's all you're doing. That's how you're living. Right? Both of those are parts of the dynamic of attachment. So you have to now really begin to understand, though the attachment is what keeps you in the world, because that's all you think about. So when you sit down and meditate, your attachments now, you see, distracts you. You see, that's all you think about, because that's all you think about before you sit. It's all you think about when you sit. That's your pattern of mind. Are you with me?
Mm-hmm.
It's habituated. It's patterned. You see? Now, when you embark upon the spiritual path, one of the first things you got to tackle, well, there's five things, as you will know, anger, lust, greed, attachment, you see, blah, 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 right? So attachment is one of those five things, right, that constitute a mind that is not healthy, A mind that is full of anger is not a healthy mind. True? A mind that is full of lust, that's not a healthy mind. A mind full of greed, that's not a healthy mind. A mind that is full of attachment, that's not a healthy mind. And a mind full of vanity, that's not a healthy mind. And the mind has to be cleansed and purified of those five fundamental qualities. Are you with me?
Yes.
Now, when you get to the attachment part, that's also a great challenge, just like trying to purify your mind of anger, ill will, hatred. That's a struggle for most people, for most of us. But it's work that has to be done. That's part of the spiritual process, right? Now, this attachment, beloved, is very difficult. There is a scripture called the Bhagavad Gita. You probably heard of it. Bilal can help those of you who was probably not familiar with that whole culture and point of view, can steer you to the Bhagavad Gita for Dummies. Okay, that help you really appreciate, you know, what that scripture. That is a scripture that is read by millions and millions of Hindus and non-Hindus because it addresses this very thing. Right? The process of what is required to deal with your attachments. So you're on the spiritual path, beloved. And the Bhagavad Gita, the spiritual path, is called Kurukshetra. That's the path. That's the battlefield that you're on. On the path, you're on a battlefield. And the battle is with you in terms of your anger, etc. But also your attachment, because there are certain attachments that you are clinging to, giving most of your time, energy, and attention to, that interferes with you fulfilling your spiritual goal. You're attached to that, and you don't want to let it go. Like Arjuna on the battlefield of Kurukshetra, he was involved in a war that is going to go on between his clan and another clan, but these two clans were related. So on the other side of the battlefield was his best friends, some cousins, some teacher, and his dharma, his duty as a warrior is to destroy, to kill. And he didn't want to kill. He couldn't understand, you know, what is the value of fighting this war? I'm going to kill cousins and relatives. You see? And Krishna is putting him with the arguments for why he should overcome these attachments and kill them. Are you with me? That's Kurukshetra, right? So you look at your attachment, and this is where it gets personal, because only you know, only the individual know what things are you attached to, what activities are you engaged in that you know you need to let go of for the sake of perfecting your sadhana practice. You know that. But like Arjuna, you don't want to let that go. You don't want to kill that behavior because it's giving you some pleasure, some satisfaction. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
And like Arjuna, you got to do your, what we call swadharma. You see? Swadharma means the duty to yourself. You have a duty to yourself, like you have a duty to your wife, your husband, your children, etc., etc., etc. You have a duty to yourself. Right? Now, part of that duty to that yourself is can be addressed and talked about, but you get my point, beloved?
Yes, sir.
So if you're going to be a spiritual seeker, you have a duty, right? That comes with it. And that duty has to be done, which means you have got to kill off all of those attachments that interfere with the performance of your spiritual duty.
Yes, sir.
And that's the battlefield. And that is war. You see, that's why I said that you are your own worst enemy.
Yes, sir.
Kabir Sahib, a Hindu saint, said it very dramatic. He said you have to draw your own sword and cut your own beard. The ego must be vanquished.
Yes,
most
most of us, when we come to a spiritual path, we do not understand that we come to the path to make our ego more comfortable. Are you with me? And that's not what the spiritual path is about or purpose for. It is to transcend your ego. And what is your ego? Fundamentally, your likes and your dislikes. It's about developing the ability to function and operate in the world and in your relationship beyond the limitations of your likes and your dislikes. In other words, to be governed by principles and not by your likes and dislikes. That's a child. You see, children are like that.
Yes, sir.
They only want what they like, and they want to avoid what they dislike. You see, you want to live your life only the way you like living and not the way you don't like living. That's the child. Jesus says when you're a child, that's appropriate, but if you're going to be a man or a woman, then definitely if you're going to be a spiritual man or woman, you better put that shit away.
Yes, sir.
No fooling, no kidding. And that's not going to feel good. Spiritual growth hurts.
Yes, sir.
You see? And that becomes your fear on the path. Man, if I stop doing those things that I like doing, even though they are counterproductive to my spiritual goal, then my life is going to become empty and meaningless. You know, if I watch 12-hour TV, there's no point in living. You know what I mean? Right?
Yes, sir.
That becomes your struggle. You see? The dissolution of what you call it, me, which is just this bundle of likes and dislikes. It's a profound matter. And one Buddhist seeker purportedly responded after having been initiated and on the path for a while, he had a grievance, you see? And he was telling that Lama, look, you know what I mean? I've been deceived here, right? If you had told me what this process was all about, I would have never, ever even came over here. You know what I mean? Like that, you wouldn't touch it with a 15-foot pole. It is dying while living. To the ego. So that's a little bit about it. But the definitive work, of course, is Bhagavad Gita. And if it's something you're interested in, I think there's some Bhagavad Gita coolers up for them, and you might want to check. See, you got the book. Okay, very good. Yeah. So look at the book, get the author, and so forth and so on. And you got Kindle and download it, you know, the techies, you know. And have to send checks in the oil problems. Are you following me?
Yes, sir.
But that's a big one. And so when you enter into the study of the Bhagavad Gita, you must enter it on the basis of understanding your Kurukshetra. What you personally are clinging to, attached to, not willing to give up for the sake of your own spiritual liberation, for the sake of your own salvation, for the sake of your own enlightenment, if you will. You're clinging to stuff and activities that you know is counterproductive, but you can't kill it like Arjuna, because you feel if I stop doing this, I'll disappear. You will disappear. The ego disappears. But that's the goal of the path. You see? It's not here to enhance your ego. It's here to transcend your ego. You see? Very different. Very different process. And you have to have the clarity and humility to understand the process is not going to make any exemption for you. You don't have to do what Buddha did. You don't have to do what Jesus did, what Mahavira did, what Dadu, what all of these real lives and entertainers have done. You don't have to do that. Ain't shit special about you that exempts you from the ordeal. At all. Are you with me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Either you're willing to pay that or you ain't going to pay it. You see? And if you don't pay
pay the price now, you'll pay it later, because you don't die. You're going to have some sickness, and you will have no ability to deal with that at all. You see? Dying hurts. Meditation hurts. You're going to hurt now, you're going to hurt later. You're going to hurt. And all of that stuff that you attach to it and hold on to, it don't disappear anyway, because nothing here is permanent. True?
True.
Nothing here lasts. Everything is changing. So all that clinging is for naught. You're going to lose all of that. You see, your body comfort, you're going to lose this whole body. Are you with me? Anyway. Now, if you did a little meditation and went to church or heard a little teaching, some, you know, the universe may have mercy and give you another shot at this. But then you'll come back and you'll just die again. That's all you've been doing. You've been coming back only to die and come back again. If you're lucky, that cycle has been on an upward scale. I mean, you started off as an ant, right? You had 12 million deaths. Or infinite death, and now you finally, you know what I mean, get a human body and piss it away. And you come back and you die again. So reincarnation, beloved, is another way of looking at it. All that is happening, you just coming and going, you just coming back here to die.
Yes, sir.
And suffer. We call it a Bhagwan, a wheel. And that's what you're on your own will. You're coming back to be crazy in the next lifetime. To be a criminal, to be a drug addict or whatever, and then die. You're coming back to be unhappy again. You're just moving in a cycle of unhappiness. Seeking to be happy now, failing at it, right? Doing all of this stuff to achieve this happiness, absolute happiness. Failing at it, and you come back again. And fail again. And fail again. Fail again. And it's going to go on for infinitum. Yes, beloved.
Guru Bhagwan.
Yes, sir.
Are we the only... Oh, I'm sorry. Are we the only beings in the universe going through this?
Look around this place. The ancient African ancestors, I don't know if you're familiar with, but in the West it's called the Hermetica. You see? The Hermetica is, or the Kybalion, it's a standard text in philosophy studies and so forth, that contains the wisdom of thought. You see, the ancient African sage Thoth. You see, the Greeks call him Trismegistus, Thoth, thrice great. But in there are seven principles that govern all of this. The first one is mentalism. We talked a little bit about that. You're now addressing the second principle that is in the Hermetica, which is the law of correspondence. As above, so below. Whatever you, is below is also above. Above meaning this cosmos, right? Now, if you go into astrophysics and astronomy and things of that nature, and you look at this place, right? You say, are we the only being? Maybe you're on, we're unique in the sense that our existence is made up of the material that is available on the planet. Are you with me? Or in this solar system, hydrogen, et cetera, et cetera. But for the way, maybe their vehicle is made out of a very different kind of thing. But as above, so below. Because life here is life everywhere. Everywhere. Now you ask, well, are they doing the same thing that we are doing? Well, that's debatable, you see. There's a possibility, but in Dogon mysticism, and in the Dogon tradition, they talk about how these beings came down, who were
a far more intelligent, gave culture, actually cultivated, you know, the species, the human species, incubated it, put it together, you see. Now, whether that is something we can accept or not, but this is Dogon mysticism, and it's a myth about creation. The yellow eye, red eye serpent, you see. But what is important is we're here. You have this precious human body with all of this beautiful equipment in it. You have an intellect, you have a mind, you see, and so forth and so on. You got to make right use of this thing, you see, because that very law of reincarnation threatens to put you in another form, you know. There's 8,400,000 different forms down here. And within each of those categories, those five of them, there's millions of them, forms of that. You follow me? And you can be one of those. Struggle. The Buddha talks about the realms, one of the realms, the Buddhism, they talk about the realm of the hungry ghost, right? That's where you have just the mind and no equipment to fulfill the desires of the mind. We call it the hungry ghost, right? Like you greedy people, right? You gotta eat something every 2 seconds. Well, you wind up in that hungry ghost realm, all that greed and all that desire for all of this, and you have no body by which you can fulfill it. That's hell. And you're gonna go through some hell in this body though as well. You see, you're gonna get old. Your body going to wear out, it's going to lose its energy, you lose your teeth, all of this good stuff is on its way out of here. And you be laying up there with a mind full of the desires you had when you were 15. And your body will not be in any condition to fulfill that desire. You won't even be able to swallow any food. You know what I'm saying? You ain't going to be able to have no sex. Some of you are already on that. I see you in your Viagra. You're Viagra shipping it every month. You understand what I'm saying? It's reality. This is reality. The teachings of these great seers are understood as being simply the teachings on reality. It's reality. There are the teachings about reality. And the reality you will, if you're fortunate, you will grow and you will get sick and this body will fall apart. Your mind is going to fall apart too in this body. You will have your dementia, you understand? Mm-hmm. Ultimately, if you live long enough, this thing winds down. This is reality. So you got a mind that is full of desires that are totally inconsistent and out of sync with where your body's at. You out of my art. You out of balance. And it's gonna get worse. And we'll be like so many people, you know. I was teasing somebody, I was saying, when the Lord of Death, Yama, comes and knocks on your door, say, okay, time. And you will protest, wait a minute. You know, you didn't give me no warning. And Yama will say, yes, I did. Didn't you see that gray hair coming? Did you notice your teeth feel like it? I gave you plenty of warning. You didn't get ready. Didn't get ready. You did not pay attention to reality. And all the prayers in the world is not going to change reality. So value your physical health, value your mental health, your emotional health, and make right use of it. Who will have the last word?
Well, now.
All right, so let's go this side. You had a turn, but don't forget to look around. Who else has the last word? And back, it's okay.
I just wanted to mention that this week, I'm still working in addictions at Rosecrans. And I utilized one of your videos. It was called The Sign of Addiction from 2001. And I played it for some of the clients that I'm working with. I don't know if they got it, but I was able to really get something out of it. I've looked at that, your videos, even though I haven't been here.
That's okay.
That sadhana of addiction, and I was able to relate that to my own ego, that cycle of suffering. You keep saying, look at your own experience. Do the research. You don't really have to do the research. Just look at your own life. And so I just want to thank you.
You're very welcome, brother.
For that
very
knowledge.
Welcome. Very welcome. Yeah. Right. And that is so true, you see. Those things that you're struggling with in terms of your attachment, that's an addiction. And the breaking of an addiction, that ain't going to be comfortable. The spiritual path is not like going to a party being given by your auntie. You follow me? This is blood sport. This is Guru-Dsiciple. This is for warriors. It's not for the faint of heart. You see? That's very beautiful, beloved. Who else had a part of these last series?
Again, Master Bhagwan.
Yes, beloved.
Now, there's universe, according to people that both of you, including some mystics, they believe that there are always alternative universe, there are alternative universe.
Mm-hmm.
For example, what is between my fingers and my hand?
Right.
You would say nothing.
But there is something.
But there is something. Mm-hmm. They talk about the string theory.
Yes,
and also get into words like singularity.
Yes, singularity.
It's another famous word, and then event horizon, which is two terms. Just simply saying, they don't know. Many try to deny the creation of God or whatever, whoever, because they look for a physical answer.
Yes, yes.
Unfortunately, or fortunately, that's why I come in.
Okay.
Thank you.
Well, yes, all of those things, as far as the alternate dimensions of that are above and so forth and so on, the Dogon people, if you look at their history of their mysticism and their wisdom tradition, they talk about those different dimensions, which startled a lot of the anthropologists that went there, because, you know, these are poor people, you know, no running water in many cases, etc. But they understood. They also understood the double helix and DNA. They had all of that. They had a map, the trajectory of Sirius B, no telescopes. They showed the position of stars during the last precession, some 25,900 years ago. They had all of that. You see? You see? They called it Sogai, deep knowledge. So yes, you see? Nothing new here. And what is very interesting, you see, science is evolving and beginning to come closer and closer to the teachings of all of these great seers and saints since time immemorial. You see, Einstein and Buddha are about to hook up, you see, and usher in a very different cultural phenomenon, you see. So it's all of that, what you say, is really true, you see? So the physicists are now saying the universe is made out of nothing. This is very compatible with the Buddhist principle of sunya, emptiness. Right? Now, in consciousness study, prior to this place that we are at now, they thought that the brain created consciousness, and now they said, no. Mm. That's no longer a valid position. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
It looked like consciousness has created everything. Consciousness is the creator. Mm. Now we really have to go sit down at a table with some tea and coffee and spend the night.
Yes, sir.
You want to know what creates? Consciousness creates. And you'll see it in your whole life. Nothing comes into existence without you being conscious of it. Consciousness creates. Consciousness is God. And you are consciousness. I'm what I'm seeing. Think about it. Consciousness is prior to the rise of the world. You weren't conscious, there will be no world. There'll be nothing. Very profound.
Mm. Yes, sir.
Very profound. You never had an experience that did not occur in your own consciousness. It's not wrong. What you're calling real, you think has a reality independent of you. That's not true. Just like a hot potato in a boiling pot of water, right? The hotness of the potato is not intrinsic to the potato, nor is the heat of the water intrinsic to water, nor is the heat in the pan that is heating the water in the potato. Heat is not an intrinsic quality of the pan. They borrow heat from fire. Are you with me? Whatever you call it real borrows reality from you. Mm-hmm. Consciousness is so. Very good. There was one more on that train of last remark of Igor, I was there.
Yeah.
Well, I tell you, based on what you just said, I think I just think about that.
Okay, then we'll give her passing and give our beloved sister an opportunity to close us out.
It appears that the Me Too movement is upon us. And I have some concerns about it.
Mm.
Primarily because as a female, I've studied myself.
Mm.
And I realized that I create a lot of the problems in my relationships with males.
Mm.
I realized that I have a contribution to the problems that I experience.
Mm.
But not going there, I want to know what would be the best response for males in light of the Me Too movement?
Well,
how do males respond to that?
Males are going to respond to what males are wired to respond to. You see, this is nature. This is what in the Samkhya philosophy we call prakriti. Nature. You see, everything that is happening here is happening according to the law of nature. You see? Mm-hmm. Now, what you do in nature is that you adapt to the reality that is going on around you. If you can't adapt, you perish. It's very simple. You see? Somehow or another, one has to become capable of accepting things. You see, based on their nature. If you want cats to bark and dogs to purr, you're going to be disappointed. this simply never going to happen. What's even worse, if you want other people to be like you, as if you are the gold standard. This is a fast track to a crazy house. And lots of suffering because that is never going to happen. And thank God it doesn't. Because if you lived in a house with everybody just like you, y'all be fighting every day, every minute of the hour. You would not be able to stand it. You follow what I'm saying? So thank God nobody's like us. That's what gives the rise. You understand? But that's the opposite of what you're trying to do. You're trying to make everybody like you.
Right.
You see?
Mind your own business. Are you with me? Be that kind of company that influence people to become like you. I mean, if that's the game you're going to play, right? If they're in your company, you become like the company you keep. Now, it depends on who's the most committed to that way of being, right? If you're with a man who's committed to being all that a man should not be, right? And if he's more committed to that than you are, then you're gonna be pulled down. So you're gonna want to be like a man now. Are you listening? Follow me. We have a men group, cooler group. I can probably sell the feedbacks and make a lot of money. Everything you want to know about men is in this cooler group. So I got a sweat on board. I'm not at liberty, right?
Yeah.
But first, you see, when you say man, all men are not at the same level of manhood. They are childish men. There's adolescent men, and then there are men. And if you have chosen a childish man to hook up with, then you'll have a real bad experience with this person. Because you're going to be expecting a childish level of man to function like a completely developed man. You see? And there is a level of manhood that is spiritual man, holy man. The experience with such a man is like what you experience when you're with God. Mm-hmm. Full of love, full of forgiveness, tolerance, patience. Mm-hmm. You see, capable of doing now, for better or worse, et cetera, et cetera. Mm-hmm. That's divine man. Mm-hmm. But see, you get what you attract. If you're a silly woman, if you're a childish woman, you're going to get a childish man. Mm-hmm. Are you with me?
Yes, true.
And what would a divine man want with you? This is the part you don't like. He said, you want an Obama, but what would Obama do with you? You don't bring anything. That's vanity. And that's a woman's greatest struggle. Arrogating to yourself value and quality that in reality you don't even possess. Do it. Woman, thy name is vanity. The spiritual progress of stages begins there. It's real talk.
Yes, sir.
Real talk. Right? In my practice over all these years, I had a lot of sisters coming, you know, and they mystified. I don't know why this man. They don't understand. Men experience love very differently than a female, you see. Men experience love in the form of the degree to which the female respects. That's his greatest psychological need, respect and trust. If you can't respect and trust, you ain't gonna hold no man. You see. There's an example of such women, a Sarada Devi here, you see? I mean, go look at them. That's the gift. There's been female realizing, trying to instruct you. In Egypt, there's the Temple of Isis. We went there, right? You see? Transforming girls into a woman. That's science. You just can't arrogate, I'm a woman. You're a female. Don't get this shit twisted. Feel me? Yeah. Perfume and lipstick and curvy bodies, that don't make you a woman. That don't make you shocky. Are you with me? I'm going to stop now, but I'm going to leave.
Thank you.
Thank you.